I'm Peggy Scott Laborde. We're not having fun, right?
No.
And welcome to Steppin Out, spotlighting the New Orleans area's arts and entertainment scene. Seated at our table tonight, Christopher Rice, author of the brand new novel, The Heavens Rise. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Good to be here.
Yes, indeed. Poppy Tucker with an exclamation point, host of the weekly program Louisiana Eats on WWNO Radio. Hello, the shy and demure Poppy Tucker, right?
Yes.
Okay, and speaking of WWNO and my pal, Susan Larson, host of The Reading Life on WWNO 89.9 FM. Hello, Miss Susan. Great to see you back. And good old Alan Smason, theater critic.
And also, with a question mark.
Yeah, with a question mark. And no, and editor of the online Crescent City Jewish News. Everything old is new again, Miss Poppy.
Well,
it's
for
great.
Any
news.
True New Orleans food lover, really the biggest thing happened in the last 10 days, and that is Patrick Singley, Gotro's owner, reopened Marty's restaurant. And I was fortunate enough to dine there last Sunday night with Kat Kinsman from Eatocracy and her husband. The restaurant had only been open 8 days. And Patrick told me specifically that he was trying not to let anybody know it was open because he was afraid he was gonna get slammed. Look, I was dying for you to see the dining room, Peggy. The fixtures, it's a little bit more elaborate than
I remember
the original Marty's.
The curtains,
it's sort of like Havana 1940s.
Okay.
Oh my God, it's gorgeous.
Fancy.
The chef there is Drew Lockett. They're open Wednesday through Sunday, and I want to point out, 5 p.m. till midnight.
Oh,
where can you go and get a meal at 11 o'clock at night?
Right.
So, of course, just like the old Marty's, they have raw oysters. Now they also have delicious roasted oysters. Oh my gosh, they were yummy. The breadcrumb topping. There's beautiful salads. We had an arugula salad. We had a lobster salad. Divine. And then, so crazy on the menu, poutine, the Canadian dish. Really wicked.
That's rare in New Orleans.
My favorite thing in the world is bone marrow. Mm-hmm. I'd rather have bone marrow than anything. As God is my witness, no place in the United States have I ever had bone marrow as good as at Marty's right now. Baked Brussels sprouts that you could make a meal in all by itself if you're a vegetarian. The cassoulet of its duck confit. They made the sausage from duck hearts. Yum! And then, of course, they send the foie gras. Like, where do you go from there? Let's have some foie gras. How about a little foie? How about grilled speckled trout? And you know what? You don't go to a restaurant like this much and order chicken. I have never tasted a chicken as perfectly roasted as that. It's exquisite. Eat the chicken. And save room for dessert. I'm not much of a dessert eater. Oh, that was the most beautiful thing. And wait till you see the tarte tartin. It was exquisite. So go to Marty's. I'll tell you what, call first. I bet the reservations are piling up.
Oh.
And now you know, it is my favorite time of the year. And I'm so excited because I get to put my witch hat on.
Oh.
I live all year for this moment. How about that?
I have to put up, yes, it's so pretty. Let's get it all the way up. There you go.
Okay. All right, so we're going to talk about Vega Tapas Cafe's Spooktacular Halloween. It's a tasting menu for $29. And of course, it's going to run Monday, October 28th through Saturday, November 2nd. It's Chef Glenn Hogue, who is, it's Criollo.
Actually, I guess we're talking Criollo
I guess we're going to talk about, there's another one. That's the Rougarou dinner. And you know, the Rougarou is a werewolf-like monster that haunts the swamps and sugarcane fields of Acadiana. Mm-hmm. So aptly named, Rougarou rum from Donner Pelletier has a very strong black strap molasses flavor and is distilled locally among the cane fields in Thibodaux. Mm. So it's a spirited dinner. It's All Hallows Eve. It's a five-course menu, and the food's delicious. And there's the chef, and every course is accompanied by a Rougarou rum cocktail.
Ooh.
Handcrafted and paired by the Carousel Bar's legendary Marvin Allen. We all know and love him. So don't miss the legend of the Rougarou. The werewolves will be out on All Hallows Eve. And so now we're going to go, I hope we're going to Vega Tapas.
Yes, you are.
That's where I and so how about six courses for $29, as I began to say. Chef Glenn Hogue, and I'm going to run through a couple of the menu items, and I don't want to scare anybody because really the food is yummy things. Black bean soup with creme fraiche, duck confit with spaghetti squash, roquefort and blackberry vinaigrette, stuffed poblano pepper with herbed goat cheese. He's calling them things like fried rat and bat innards with pulled fish, pulled flesh. And I'm not going to even tell you what's festering with shards of glass for dessert, but don't be afraid by the menu. It's Glenn's food and it's yummy.
I'm glad it's a few days too, because if it was all like one night and not everybody could do that, so it's going to last a few days.
Put your hat on, get on your broomstick, and go down Metairie Road every night next week.
Okay. And talk about on the road and busy bee. You have quite the list, Miss Susan, of books out.
I am weak with hunger, however. So thank you, Poppy. So this is the rundown. We're deep into fall right now, and so all the big books are coming along, which is fantastic for all of us. And we'll start off with a new novel from Anne Rice, The Wolves of Midwinter, second in her werewolf trilogy, which I adore, and I especially love this book because it's a Christmas book. It's a winter book. You read it and you feel cool and awake and alive, which is great. And then we have just had the smallest, most wonderful autograph party in the world for Chris Rice's book, The Heavens Rise. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
A supernatural thriller that is just so full of love for New Orleans that it is truly a pleasure to read, really. And then moving on, everyone is talking about Becky Thieme's book, Hell and High Water, The Daily The Battle to Save the Daily Times-Picayune, which is chock full of stories. Sad, true stories. Mm-hmm. So, and then Deb Burst, going to the Sublime for a change, has this gorgeous hallowed halls of Greater New Orleans. Cathedrals, churches, sanctuaries, really lovely book with essays that give a little bit of the history of those places. And she's out and about around town with this book now. And then, of course, there's Errol Laborde's book, Mardi Gras, Chronicles of the New Orleans Carnival, which I fully expect will be a big Christmas present this year. It's just beautiful. And Errol knows so much about carnival. It's such an addition to our carnival knowledge.
And there's recipes, too.
That's right. There's recipes.
Of course.
What's a carnival without food? And then a writer I'm really interested in is Tim Parrish, who is a Baton Rouge writer who wrote Red Stick Men, a fabulous collection of short stories. But his new book is called Fear and What Follows. Oh, I skipped Roger, but we'll come back. Okay. But Fear and What Follows, The Violent Education of a Christian Racist, is about growing up in Baton Rouge in a different time, different place, big changes, family struggle. And it is really a very, very powerful memoir. And he's also come out with his first novel, The Jumper, at the same time. So he's having a little rush of publication. And then Roger Kamenetz, the great poet, has collaborated with a New York artist named Michael Hofka on these great poems, To Die Next to You. And the paintings match the poems, and they are really striking and lovely. And then Bill Joyce, Oscar winner, you know, Oscar winner, winner of everything, is back with The Mischievians. And if you ever wonder how you lose something in your house or misplace something, The Mischievians are to blame. And then this is my favorite, well, it's one of my favorite nonfiction books this fall, so I don't get into trouble. The Unfathomable City, A New Orleans Atlas, which is, it's been edited by Rebecca Solnit and Rebecca Snedeker, who's the maker of that Mardi Gras documentary. And this is a striking atlas of New Orleans, 25 exquisite maps, the work of artists, the work of writers, great essays to go with every map, like there's a map of second lines, there's a map of parade routes with oak canopies above them. It's very striking combination, so it's a don't miss book. And then next weekend is one of the biggest weekends of the year because it's the Louisiana Book Festival all over the state capitol grounds, the state library, the capitol. You get to sit in your legislator's, you know, seat and probably make better decisions than they do. And it's terrifically empowering, I have to tell you. And Christine Wiltz will be getting the Louisiana Writer Award this year, which is really sweet. Yeah. And she'll get that first thing Saturday morning at 10 o'clock in the House chamber, and then I'll be interviewing her later that day. And a lot of former winners will be there that day to talk about their own books. never miss a chance to see Ernest Gaines. He is so one of our great, great treasures. And Shirley Ann Grau will be back. Cool. She's a former Louisiana Writer Award winner. Yeah. And one of the special, special guys who's coming this year is a guy named Josh Hannegarns, who wrote a book called The World's Strongest Librarian, about living with Tourette's and about the power of libraries and knowledge and reading. And he's very inspiring and wonderful. And then Bill Joyce will do a little double duty up at the Louisiana Book Festival as well. And then the great and adorable Wally Lamb will be there with his new book, We Are Water. Mm-hmm. And Wendy Rodrigue, we get to hear from the other side of the Rodrigue family this time with a fabulous new memoir and blog entries called The Other Side of the Painting, in which she tells how it was she came to fall in love with George and what their marriage is like, and gives us this terrific look at what it's like to be a muse, what it's like to be an art critic, what it's like to care so passionately about somebody's life's work. And it's all free. It's all
it
free,
such a deal.
So you can't
beat
it. So drive on up to Baton Rouge. It'll be a blast.
It is, you know, the setting is extremely unique, as you said.
It is.
Actually, some of the sessions are in the Capitol itself, and you do get to sit in those chairs.
So. You do. I love that so much.
It is. It's really quite the ambiance. Well, my goodness, Christopher, tell us about your book, another scary one, number 6.
Well,
congratulations.
Thank you. I think the most important thing about my book is that the cover matches your beautiful blouse.
Yes, we have to point this out.
So if you buy it in the next 5 minutes, Peggy will autograph her blouse and send it to you, FedEx. But we only have one blouse like
this. That's right, there's only one.
You got to go. You know, it's just your basic Parasite in the Swamp gives you the power to control minds novel.
That's
it. You know, it's just one of those.
There's so many of those.
I thought I hadn't written one yet, so why not take a stab at it? No, it's really, I thank you for your summary, Susan. It is a book that I hope is full of love for Louisiana. I wrote a book that was set here 10 years ago that was a very different novel. It was a very angry young man's novel. This is about characters who, while there is a supernatural force encroaching upon them, they are united in their belief that New Orleans needs to be protected and preserved. So I hope that, aside from being an entertaining page-turning supernatural thriller, it has some deeper levels in it that I go for.
Well, of course, much of your life was spent in New Orleans, and I was thrilled we were sharing some memories of North Theater. I was in plays a little bit before you.
Just a little
bit.
Yeah.
But you were Pippin.
I was Pippin. It was my shining moment. I was Pippin. And I was Pippin because my parents canceled a cruise we were all supposed to go on. We were going to be out of town for most of that summer, so I went to the audition with Ty Tracy and Bob Bruce and Gloria Gallo, all those people, on a whim. And I didn't expect to get cast, and I was cast in the lead role. And apparently Ty Tracy said when I walked in, "This kid is so tall, I hope he can do something." Because we want a tall child.
That's how you qualify.
In the play. And if you remember, the stage at Nord is small.
It's petite.
And every child, I think, in New Orleans fit on that stage for that production. It was all of us. We were dancing and singing. There wasn't much room, but, you know, it was great. It was a wonderful experience, you know.
Book tours. You're on one with your mom.
Yes.
With your mom. And as we said, brand new. She also has a new book. Next is Dallas. What's it like to be in a book tour these days?
Well, it's challenging and interesting. It's better if you're with Anne Rice. I'll tell you that much. Because a lot more people come. And you get to go to very nice places and very nice bookstores. I think it's, you know, the market for books is changing. And it's been very challenging. Most of it's going online. The ebook readership is growing. My sales are about 50% ebook and 50% physical books.
Really?
So I'm not really being pulled in one direction or the other. I still have to sort of play both sides of the fence. But writing is a lonely business. So if you're able to go out into the world and talk to anybody, it's good for your mental health. You know, but the outpouring of love for her is always inspiring to see, and there's a little bit for me too. And coming home to New Orleans is particularly special. Tonight we're going to the Lestat Ball, which is the first time we've been in 10 years, I believe, and so it's very emotional.
And you're
going
to be busy this weekend. You've got book signings coming up, which we'll be showing shortly, at Garden District, and also on the North Shore too.
Yes, I will be at what used to be a Books a Million in Covington. People were writing me concerned because they said, you know, the Books a Million closed. closed. Well, it did, but it reopened as 2nd and Charles, which is at 401 Highway 190 in Covington. I'll be there Saturday at 2 o'clock. Mm-hmm. And then Sunday is the big event at Garden District Books, and that's both of us. That's me and Mom signing together.
And that should be packed. But yeah. I understand you have to get a ticket for it. You buy your book, and
yes.
So just be aware to kind of prepare a little bit if you are going to go and visit with them. But you all in Garden District have had a long relationship.
Mm-hmm. In fact, I felt so terrible. On Saturday night, I'm taking Amy Lowy out to dinner. I left her off the acknowledgments page of the book.
Oh.
She was one of the first reads for the manuscript. She read it to make sure I had gotten everything right post-Katrina because I hadn't lived here after the storm, and I neglected to put her on the acknowledgments page. So I'm sorry, Amy. We're going to have a great dinner, and I've posted about this on Facebook about 9 times, and I'll keep posting about it until everybody forgets.
When you come back to New Orleans, do you go and visit some of your old haunts? No pun intended.
I do visit my old haunts. I love the French Quarter. I'm staying in the French Quarter this time out, which is a new experience because it's very loud, which I didn't realize having been an uptown boy. I was up most of the night listening to people, but it's wonderful. And you know, the Garden District in Uptown. It's a little bittersweet to drive past St. Elizabeth's. That's a little hard because there's so many fond memories associated with that building. But I'm glad that people are living there. I'm glad it's not just some institution.
Yes, no, it's so beautiful. It's still so beautiful.
It's gorgeous.
When you're working on a book, do you ever say, hey, Mom, what do you think of that? Do you all get any feedback from each other at all?
This is the first book that I gave to her in manuscript form and asked for her to give me notes on. And
Really? Yes,
because it was a supernatural book, and I wanted to make sure that, as with her books, that the universe of it was clear and elegant, that no matter how extraordinary the events, because it involves mind control and monsters and various things, that the explanation isn't like, you know, that third season of Lost where nobody could tell what was happening and they were just pulling it out of their hat. So I wanted, she helped me, she gave me some feedback that was about refining the backstory.
Wow. Yeah. All right. Well, good. Well, we're so glad you're here.
I'm glad to be here.
And Mr. Allen, you're up, kiddo.
I am. Barely, but I am. I'm going back and forth. I got to say one thing. There's something magical about Bob Eades anytime he dons a dress. Yes, indeed. Thanks to Running with Scissors, we get an opportunity to see Bob Eades in a dress again in Miss Gulch Returns. This time, we're whisked magically and musically away to The Wizard of Oz, the MGM film, of course. This one-man musical was written originally by Fred Barton back in 1983, but it still holds up remarkably well. In the original work, Barton played the piano himself, but this time, Bob is accompanied by none other than James Walpole on the piano, and tinkling the ivories, as it were. And at first, Eades essentially plays himself in the tuxedo. He's a man looking for love in all the wrong places, especially when he goes up against Elmira Gulch, who he spies in a bar. And after he is rebuked, you have to think how lowly that is that Elmira Gulch had rebuked you. There's a transformation, and of course we see Elmira in all of her splendor. Now, Eades plays Gulch as a misunderstood character who really just wants to be loved. After all, she never got to sing her song, which is, can we just say it rhymes with which? All right. One of the biggest and most well-known numbers in this particular group of songs is Pour Me a Man, a very clever anthem filled with triple shots and double entendres. And Eades handles the dialogue in the songs very well. Again, those of you who want to know what an Elmira Gulch cocktail is, it's mostly bitters. The language is a bit racy, and the themes are adult-like, but Miss Gulch Returns is a comic romp for Eades. I'd recommend it very highly, a little adult humor for you. That's at the Mid-City Theater playing for this weekend. This will be the last weekend. Let's move on to something a little bit more interesting, a little bit more strange, and I guess in keeping with the Halloween theme, Cripple Creek Theater Company has been presenting Andrew Vaught's a work in progress, but it is being presented now, Possum Kingdom. This is something he wrote 3 years ago, and he's revamped it with the members of the Cripple Creek Players, and they basically are presenting this at the St. Claude Truck Farm at 3020 St. Claude Avenue. And this is an artist colony, if you will, that several artists have, and it's a plot of undeveloped land. The play, which has an underlying theme of depletion of natural resources, is well placed in the middle of this natural setting. However, be forewarned, it does get very chilly out there and the mosquitoes can get quite hungry. So if one is not prepared with long sleeves and sweaters and things of that sort and possibly a little bit of bug spray, you'll enjoy this though. This is Possum Kingdom, directed by Bonnie Gable. And the concept is far from simple. It's largely focusing on institutions that are unprepared for change and must deal with the consequences of that change. Locally, we might think about perhaps the BP oil spill and how that affected so many of the businesses, the disastrous effect across the board and what that means. Essentially, the members of this village, if you will, that is living out in the wild are essentially trying to gather ambrosia. I guess that's sort of a play on ambrosia. And they're trying to labor getting this ambrosia, this brosia, and sending it off to the urban people who then feed them, send them cans of food. It's kind of a little bit involved. Dylan Hunter, Philip Yiannopoulos, Kate Kuhn, Martin Bradford are the respective laborers, Alder, Fitz, Mergery, and Patterson. And then they have some possums who are out in the field. They're played by Odila Del Giudice, Ezra Lowry, and Kristen Gremion. And of course, Andrew Vaught plays the part of Inman, who is the trader who trades all of this brosia for food. Essentially, you'll see that the storyline is surrealistic. It takes place, again, with a lot of lighting, different effects that they have, and it's worth seeing. It's very compelling. It's a brave work that is very interesting, and I would recommend it. It's an experience. You will be out in the natural setting and, again, bring bug spray. Meanwhile, last week, Poppy talked about a restaurant having a small green footprint. Well, I'm here to talk about green footprints and red footprints and even gold and silver footprints, all securely fitted into high heels because it belongs to the most famous and beautiful performing women ever to grace the stage. It's all part of the longest running show from Las Vegas, and it's Frank Marino's Divas Las Vegas. Mm. There you have them. They boast the best looking men to ever slide into a gown. At the show, you'll hear the music of Britney Spears, Katy Perry, and Pink, along with pop favorites like Dionne Warwick, Tina Turner, Dolly Parton, Shania Twain, and Reba McEntire. And the illusion is very real. The performers are absolutely riveting. The one thing you probably would want to know is that they're not singing their own songs. They are performing to the original versions. Frank Marino plays Joan Rivers. He's the MC, and while he does have a bit of racy language, the source is, I think, very fun. It's a drag show, really, to outdo all drag shows. It's playing only for the next few days at Harris Theater, and keep that in mind. Another thing coming up very soon is The Mountaintop. This is written by Katori Hall. It's a play that ran on Broadway for 2 years starring Samuel L. Jackson and Angela Bassett. It's written, again, as I mentioned, Katori Hall, who did it, set in Memphis. Now, this is important to know. This is the last night on Earth that Martin Luther King Jr. was alive, and he spends the night in this hotel in Memphis with this woman. Now, it is not salacious. It is a story about the woman and about her life, and it really is a compelling story. I would recommend it very highly for those of you who have not had it. Anthony is very high on this, and I think that you know, when he gets high on things, it's important to know about. Also, for Halloween, we have some happenings going on that have to do with theater. Let's talk about it. First off, Evil Dead the musical is playing through November the 1st at the Shadowbox Theater. Then the Louisiana Philharmonic Orchestra is presenting Psycho, a symphonic night at the movies, coming up tomorrow night. And the Island of Dr. Fitzmaurice plays starting October 30th through November the 2nd. That'll be at Mid-City Theater. All of that's going
to
be fun.
Thank you very much, Al. Lots to do. And now it is time for our artist spotlight. And tonight we are featuring the photograph Gypsy Lou Webb and Charles Bukowski in Tucson, 1967. It is part of the exhibition Alternative Imprints, John Webb, Gypsy Lou, and the Hand-Sewn World of the Lou John Press. And of course, that's at the Historic New Orleans Collection right now. And the exhibit will be on view at the Williams Research Center on Charter Street through November 16th. Call 523-4662 or visit hnoc.org for more information. A reminder that you can check out Steppin' Out's online calendar at wyes.org, including info on rock drummer Liberty DeVito, who's going to be performing tomorrow at Loyola's Roussel Performance Hall at 11 a.m. New Orleans Magazine's quiz queen, Julia Street, has a question for us. Last time, Susan G. Talley gave us the name of the nationally known nightclub at the Roosevelt. That, of course, for many, many years was there, and that was the Blue Room. Now, tonight's question. The 1959 LSU Halloween touchdown run is one of Louisiana's most famous sports moments. Who made the run and against what team? Okay, hush, hush, hush. Okay, say your answers. Everyone's to raise their hand. Just step out at WYS.org. And we have our prizes, a Louisiana Life magazine subscription, a gift certificate for Vianne's Tea House, offering their culinary and gourmet tea experience for two, a copy of the book Statuesque New Orleans by Ashley Merlin, and a T-shirt, Gay Sperling, founder and CEO of wearablevegetables.com, is wearing a t-shirt with the message, red beans and rice.
Yeah. Great. I went to high school with Ashley Merlin.
Oh, you How's did? That? All right. Woo. And we have another special prize this week. A pair of tickets to see Tony and Tina's wedding at the Joy Theater. And that's next Friday, November 1st at 6:30 p.m. The interactive show is celebrating its 25th anniversary of its off-Broadway run. Performances begin, as we said, next Tuesday, the 29th, and run all the way through next Saturday, November 2nd. Ticket prices include an Italian buffet, champagne toast, and a slice of wedding cake. Call 528-9569 or go to thejoytheater.com for more information. And now our picks. Did you want to say something?
I just was going to say that it's like being at a real Italian
it's
wedding.
Be so you know. Much fun. Okay. All right, Miss Poppy.
Okay. Don't miss Monday night the launch of John Besh's new book, Cooking from the Heart, at the Bourne Restaurant in the High. At $65 includes the book. And don't forget to mix it up for Liberty's Kitchen at Pesh on Sunday, November 2nd. That's when you eat good and do good.
All right, Susan.
And to warm up for Ann and Chris on Sunday, I will be doing a book signing at Catholic Bookstore Saturday from 11 to 1 for the Book Lover's Guide. Then go on over to Garden District Sunday afternoon. And then next Friday is a big, big night. Wally Lamb at 6 at Garden District, and then Bill Joyce at 6 at Octavia Books.
All right, Alan.
I just want to remind everybody that this coming Halloween night at Chateau de Lac, we're going to have our WYS Season of Good Taste dinner. And thanks to the good folks at Southern Costume Company, I'm going to be in costume. Costumes are preferred. Everybody come. Only
okay.
$85.
Okay, Chris.
Excellent. Well, every Sunday night, we debut a new episode of my internet radio show, The Dinner Party Show, with Christopher Rice and Derek Shaw Quinn, and that's on your computer at the dinner. DinnerPartyShow.com or via our free
really
mobile
funny.
App.
It's very funny.
Funny. Thank you.
Congratulations.
I'm glad you think so.
And my picks, the Southern Food and Beverage Museum is sponsoring a fundraiser home kitchen tour. That's on Allard Boulevard. That's tomorrow from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. Go to southernfood.org for details. The Marigny neighborhood is having their own festival. That's also tomorrow at Washington Square, Washington Square Park at Frenchman and Royal. Walking tours, food, and music. And author Deborah Burst, whom we mentioned earlier, will discuss eating and drinking at funerals, the traditions on Sunday at the newly opened Southern Food and Beverage Museum Library at 1609 Aretha Castle Haley Boulevard. And finally, Michael Bartnick and Carol Britt will perform a free concert. That's on Sunday at 7 p.m., including works by Handel and others. And that's at the Community Church Unitarian Universalist on Fleur-de-Lis Boulevard. And that's in Lakeview. Next week, a toast to Prohibition's anniversary, the repeal of Prohibition, that is, and pianist Terry Marone Jr. gracing our studio here. Thank you all very much. Thanks for watching. Thanks for being here. Good night.